Hello, I'm Dr. Gorgon, and we are here today to tell you about threads and why you should be interested in them. Baby Oliver is very interested in threads. And as a programming concept, you should be too. Threads are one of the innovations that allow you to run your code on multiple cores at the same time in parallel. But first, a little bit more about what threads are. So your traditional view of a process only has a single stream of execution in it. That means that it can only be run on a single core at a time, and there's no way to really break it up. So in particular, a single process has access to its code and data and files. That process has a single stream of execution. Inside of the process's memory, it has access to its code, data, and files, as well as its stack. But part of what is kept for it in the operating system through the process control block also includes its program counter and what was in the registers the last time it was able to run on the CPU. That's just a single stream of execution in a single process. However, if we start creating more threads in that process, each thread becomes its own stream of execution. And that stream of execution also has its own set of registers for what was in the CPU the last time that thread got to run, which includes its program counter, which tells it where it was inside of the code. The information about these individual threads can be kept inside of the process's memory. The process is aware of the contents of the stack for each individual thread. One of the benefits of using threads is that threads are able to share data by default, whereas processes need to use inter-process communication like shared memory or message passing. The overall downside of utilizing threads in order to make your processing go faster, is that typically threads are capped at the amount of speed up you can end up getting from your parallelism. You can continue adding threads to your process until you run out of cores to schedule them on. After you run out of cores to schedule them on, adding more threads doesn't really speed up your process at all. So one of the benefits of adding threads rather than new processes is that threads are very lightweight in comparison to processes. You can add one faster than you can add a process itself. Threads share resources by default, whereas processes do not get to share resources at all unless they use inter-process communication like message passing or shared memory. Threads do not take up additional space inside of the operating system's kernel memory. They do not require having pages of their own. Threads, generally speaking, are more economical because they share space in memory. Threads also scale very well because they can be scheduled on multiple cores. Because threads share data but don't share the same program counter or registers, they can be scheduled onto different cores. That means you can have as many threads currently executing as the number of cores that you have on your computer. When you are working with inter-process communication, you can have those communicating across multiple different computers. Threads, generally speaking, will only parallelize within a single processor. Threads let you run your program on more than one core at a time. However, there are some challenges. We have to find intelligent ways of dividing activities so that each thread has a reasonable amount of work to do. Otherwise, whichever thread has the most work to do is going to be the bottleneck on your program. When we balance the amount of work between the multiple threads, we end up with a shorter running program overall that is more efficient. One of the ways that we can do that is by splitting data across multiple threads, but that is something that we're going to talk about in a different video. One of the challenges, though, is dependencies. So if some data depends on other data in order for the process to run correctly. That's something that the programmer has to be aware of as you design your code. One of the major challenges of working with threading is testing and debugging, because your events will happen out of order. You will only be able to guarantee that the events that happen within a single thread stay in order. And anytime you introduce new threads, there's no guarantee on what order those threads are going to end up completing. So here's an example to motivate why it might be useful to have threads. If you are creating a server, you want to have one thread that is going to be listening for incoming requests from the client. Anytime a new message has been initiated from a new client, the server might spin off a new thread to handle that connection. That allows the initial thread to continue listening for additional client requests, while the new thread is going to be able to serve the request that just came in from a client. So this is illustrating one of the challenges. Understanding the order in which things are going to happen on a single core system once you introduce concurrent execution is difficult. One possibility is that you're going to see each thread execute in turn for a short fixed period of time. There's no guarantee on that. They can occur in any order. It's possible that one thread is going to completely finish before any other thread actually begins. And running multiple threads on a single core will not give you speed up. But what it can give you is independence of different tasks running. Once you allow multiple cores, now we can have multiple individual instructions running in parallel or at the same time. So this is showing that we have threads 1 and 3 pinned to core 1 and threads 2 and 4 pinned to core 2. Without pinning threads to individual cores, there's no guarantee on where they are going to run. Threads do better, generally speaking, when they are running where their data is, which means that it is useful to be able to pin cores both for knowing where they are running, but also for more efficient execution. Threading can be done either at the user level or at the kernel level. User level threading libraries don't necessarily provide speed up. The three primary thread libraries that allow a user to control and create threads are POSIX, pthreads, Win32 threads, and Java threads. In this class, we're going to utilize POSIX pthreads. User-level threading libraries do not necessarily have any support at the operating system level, and as such, it may be the case that the process itself is doing the scheduling for the threads. One of the issues with that is that does not necessarily provide a speed up, because if the operating system only sees the process and not the user threads underneath, it can't pin them to different cores and it cannot actually run those threads in parallel. However, we do have some kernel libraries, and all of these operating systems, including Windows, Solaris, Linux, and macOS, all support kernel level threading libraries. So when we use our POSIX pthreads, those are supported by the kernel on most of the operating systems that you will try running them on. In the next video, we'll talk about models of mapping these user level threads to kernel threads, which is going to help us with the process of CPU scheduling, since everything that we've talked about with CPU scheduling so far is assuming that we are only scheduling processes using process control blocks, and threads do not have additional process control blocks that help us with scheduling. Hopefully at this point in time, you have a better understanding of why you should appreciate threads. We'll see you next time.